This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Today on Dreamland, we have a guest back with us who is familiar to some of you. It's been a while since Nick Pope has been on Dreamland, though, and Nick has always got a lot to say about the things that we find interesting, and this is a very good time to talk to someone who has as much inside information as Nick does. He ran the British government's UFO project from 1991 and from 1991 to 1994, researched and investigated UFOs, abductions, crop circles, and strange phenomena. The media began to call him the real Fox Mulder, and that was on the one hand appropriate. On the other hand, when I first met Nick in London many, many years ago, he was a cheerful-looking British civil servant, complete with bowler hat, and looked as far from Fox Mulder as you could possibly imagine. He is familiar to everybody now as one of the leading researchers and consultants in this field. Nick, welcome to Dreamland, or I should say, welcome back to Dreamland.
Thank you, Whitley. It's great to be back on the show. And as you say, it has been a time, but my goodness, what an interesting moment to be having this conversation.
Yes, indeed. It is an extraordinarily interesting moment. And, you know, I want to start out with something that I've been asking a lot of people who were sort of involved in the nuts and bolts level of this when they were in government, or and oddly enough, you know, I can talk to people who were in government now. You were a pioneer in coming out, but there's a number of others now. In any case, how did you react in those days when you were in the Ministry of Defense to the alien abduction phenomenon?
It was a very difficult problem, to be honest with you. And the reason it was difficult was that our terms of reference were fairly narrowly defined, and they were limited to looking at UFO sightings that took place in the United Kingdom Air Defense region, and specifically looking at them, investigating them, but researching the phenomenon more generally to assess the defense implications for the United Kingdom. So the question was, could we legitimately, with those terms of reference, cast the net a little bit wider and look at some of these other things, which you kind of felt were connected, but in strictness, some might say, fell outside our TORs. And the answer was that we said to ourselves, look, if any of this is real, we have to take a holistic view. And we don't want to be in the business of ignoring data. So let's find a way to look at abductions and maybe crop circles too. Because if this is all part of the puzzle, we don't want to be too self-restricting and say, well, technically it's not a UFO sighting. Because actually, and this was the hook we hung it on, you could say if these events are taking place as reported, then I guess they are going into and out of a UFO. So it was a little bit of a sleight of hand. It was difficult, but it was not impossible.
Now, and did you draw any conclusions at all?
Several. Our first, and in one respect, our most important conclusion was that there was something going on over and above hoaxing and pathology. Now, there's no getting away from the fact that some of the reports we got, whether it was alien abductions or UFOs, were just made up. Actually, yes. I think a fairly small proportion, maybe a much smaller proportion than civilian UFO research groups would get, because I think people were rightly concerned that hoaxing the government might not be a very good idea.
I think they have every reason to be concerned about that, especially in Britain, where it's a dimmer view of that is taken there than here.
Yes, I think there might have been a knock on the door and the real life men in black might have shown up. And right. at the least, there would have been a stern warning about wasting government time. So right. Anyway, we did get some hoaxes, but not many. Also, psychopathology, again, whether it is, and these are very, very difficult terms, of course, but whether it's mental illness or whether it's hallucinogens, you know, sometimes brought about by a state of mind, but other times by, you know, ingesting various substances. Again, that explained maybe a small number of these cases, but to answer your original question, our biggest take home was that when you strip all that out, there seemed to be a core phenomenon, something, the movie Close Encounters of the Third Kind has that wonderful line, ordinary people in extraordinary situations. And that's, I think, what we were dealing with.
Yeah, and those situations were just, especially during the abduction period. Incidentally, just, and this isn't exactly an aside, but I feel that there was a period of time, a specific period of time, when the abduction phenomenon ramped up, became quite common, and then slowly dropped off from about 1960 to somewhere around 2000. And by 2000, they were rather rare. But in the mid-70s, unbeknownst certainly to me, they were quite common. They were happening to a lot of people, which is why when Communion came out in 1987, there was such an explosion of response to that face on the cover. And all of these people wrote letters, but the great majority of those letters were about things that happened in the 70s. Are you aware of this trajectory or not?
I am aware of it, but I think there are some confounding factors here. And I mean, yeah, one can look at the 70s and say that in some respects, it's almost the golden age of a lot of this. And then the
not
movie.
Exactly golden, but the age of, yes.
But and then, of course, I know it's not an abduction movie, but Close Encounters of the Third Kind put the wider UFO issue well and truly on the pop culture map. But right. you can say that whether it's the Charles Hickson and Calvin Parker case at Pascagoula in what I think 73, or whether it's Travis Walton 75, there were some classic cases in the 70s, many, many more, of course. But I think I was going to mention Communion. And this is the confound that to a certain extent, the more you go forward in time, and when you begin to hit the period where Communion came out and put that image into the mind's eye of the wider world, not just the UFO community. And then in parallel with that, you had the work of Bud Hopkins with Intruders and a number of other books. Then John Mack came onto the scene. And then, of course, you get the internet and then social media. But my point, this is I don't know what you'll think of this, but for a while, if you talk, now I'm taking you, sorry, Whitley, I'm taking you out of the equation here. Because,
no, that's fine. Please do.
But in one sense, I think you are both an experiencer and a researcher.
Yes,
so,
that's very true.
So I'm kind of taking you out of that and focusing on the people who maybe were just the researchers of it. And I think there was an argument for saying that in the early 90s, there was that period of time where there was the triumvirate of Bud Hopkins, Dave Jacobs, and John Mack, who were leading the charge on this. Now, obviously, there were many, many other people, Barbara Lamb, Yvonne Smith, many, many more. But Hopkins, Jacobs, and Mack were, I think, arguably the highest profile of those people. And then, of course, we lost two of them. You know, so So it's like a three-legged stool with two legs now no longer there. And my, I guess it's a sort of long-winded way of saying, have the abductions really stopped? Or have we been robbed of the means whereby, through these high-profile researchers, a lot of this got into the public eye?
Well, you know, that's an absolutely terrific question. I think it's one of the best questions I've heard in a long time about the abduction phenomenon. And my only thought is this: the Free organization finds fewer and fewer abduction reports being submitted. MUFON finds the same, and so do we at Unknown Country. So it could be that sort of two things are happening. One is there is less research attention being paid, and less high level research attention being paid on the one hand. On the other hand, they are dropping off, but it's really very difficult to tell for sure. I think that should be noted that the abductions could have gone underground, but in two ways. One of them is, and now speaking as an experiencer, the last time I had a missing time experience was just a couple of months ago, about 3 hours before I was going to meet with Mark Sims and Danny Sheehan, two people who would be of great interest to whoever can do things like missing time. So they're still out there. Are they also abducting people? I don't know. And it's we're going to have to sort of leave that question open, I suppose.
Well, let me come back on that, because I think that's important. There are two competing theories here. One is that literally those data are correct and they reflect a decline in all of this. And I've heard a couple of theories bandied around, and I'm sure you have too. Maybe you've even put forward these theories. But one theory is that if this is some sort of hybridization program, then there comes a point in a program where you pretty much have all or most of the material you need, and the program begins to wind down. And tied to that is the theory that if this is some sort of experiment or other program, eventually you've got enough samples and you've pretty much got what you want. I know that anthropocentrism is a huge problem here, but in every program or project or study, whatever you call it, that we have as humans, eventually it runs down. It comes to an end.
Right.
And so maybe that's the stage that we're in with the abduction phenomenon. But tied in to my point about Hopkins, Jacobs, and Mack is the other elephant in the room, which is that everything else that has been going on recently, ATIP, the US Navy videos, what's going on in Congress, has taken the focus of this, and maybe even with the experiences themselves, made them think, well, you know what? You know, there was a lot of talk of this back in the 90s and the early 2000s, but now the focus has shifted, and maybe I won't come forward because maybe I won't really get the receptive audience that I want or the help, because the center of gravity of all of this now seems to be very tightly focused on government, military, intelligence, community, UFO sightings.
Another thing may be that there are no big books coming out about abductions from abduction researchers. My books have, for the most part, been about my own experience. The people like Bud Hopkins and John Mack aren't there anymore. So there's no huge book about abductions. And the other thing is that the publishing industry has become very reticent about these subjects just in general. In fact, the more they seem to come into definition in the real world, the more the publishing industry, the conventional publishing industry, wants to not publish them. And now we've come up to a break. Free Dreamlanders, listen up and do the things that you are asked to do, mainly subscribe to unknowncountry.com. And interestingly enough, I will say that a lot of you are doing that and you're having a great experience because the site's full of social media possibilities. You can comment on shows, you can interview, you can interface with other people, and there's a huge archive. People are enjoying it, and I'm glad of that. We'll be right back. Where is the unknown country? Is it out there in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. Unknowncountry.com. There's no place like it in the world. We're talking to Nick Pope. His website, nickpope.net. The best place to find him is on Twitter at nickpopemod. That's Nick Pope Mod, at Nick Pope Mod on Twitter. Now, before we stopped, Nick, we were just beginning to talk about the absence of researchers and building resistance. And I've noticed in the being of an author who has gone to independent publishing on my own, through my own company, that there was a definite hardening against this whole subject when, after the 2017 revelations in the New York Times, it was as if that now that it was less speculative, people's unconscious fears were emerging and they didn't want to deal with these subjects anymore, in the publishing industry in particular. But what about the idea that this sort of resurgence of social rejection is silencing abductees who are still out there?
Yes, I think that is absolutely a factor. And I have a guilty confession, which I'm going to share with you in a moment. I just wanted to circle back and pick up one final point from our little discussion before the break about the lack of books on this, and say that one book that I had hoped would make a real splash and bring this back front and center was Ralph Blumenthal's book, The Believer, about John Mack. And it's one of the last books on abduction that I read. And of course, it's about abduction, but mainly it's about John Mack and his wider life and some of the other issues that he was involved with. And of course, famously, his struggle with the academic authorities at Harvard Medical School over his academic freedom to conduct research into alien abductions, a fight that the crusading lawyer Danny Sheehan, of course, got involved.
Exactly. The same Danny Sheehan I had a missing time experience just before a meeting recently.
Well, so I read that book, and I don't know what kind of a splash it made, but one thing that does occur to me is that I don't know what the situation is with film rights, but obviously I think it would make a great human interest story about one courageous academic struggle against the bureaucracy and the inertia and the skepticism and the debunking and things. So maybe that's something for the future.
Well, maybe so. I wish there was a film to be made, but I haven't heard anything from Ralph about it. And I think he probably would let me know if he had a film deal going, he would ask me questions about it because I've done a few of those. And,
well, I hope that the sorts of Hollywood people that you know, we all know, are looking at his book and that they have a sort of aha moment and they realize.
I should say so.
I mentioned the guilty confession, and it ties in with your question about what happened post December 2017 with the New York Times coverage of ATIP and the US Navy videos and what that maybe did to abductees and in terms of making them feel that they didn't quite have the receptive atmosphere into which they could step. And my guilty confession is that I think a number of people in this field self-censor, and I'm guilty of this. This is why I say it's my guilty confession. When I engage with the media on all of this, whatever it is, I think it's human nature that you want to play the strongest hand that you have. And at the moment, there's no getting away from the fact that the strongest hand we have is the hand, you know, where one card is ATIP, where another card is the US Navy videos, where another card is the classified briefings in Congress, where another of our cards is the ODNI preliminary assessment dated June 25th. So when we're asked about all of this, when I say we, I mean anyone in this field, I think we kind of put abductions on the back burner and say, well, yeah, what's going on right now is really fascinating. Watch Congress, watch the US Navy, watch Lou Elizondo and James Lukatsky and some of these players. And we feel, I think, that just at this point where we're managing successfully, I would say, to transition the subject of UFOs out of the fringe and into the mainstream, with all of this, we don't want to risk it by saying, oh, and by the way, let's have another look at alien abductions. Because I think the journalists, the mainstream journalists who look after the defense and national security beat, they can just about live with US Navy videos of all this, but ask them to look at people being sort of, you know, taken out of their beds and through their glass windows and into a spaceship, and you lose that audience.
Yeah, you do. I know quite a few people in that audience, obviously. And they have been very frank with me, the ones that will talk to me, which is not all of them. Lou Elizondo will not just not interview on this show. He won't even talk to me privately because he's so afraid of being tarred with the abduction brush and being discredited by it. And Christopher Mellon has said very frankly to me in an email that he does not want the abduction issue to emerge at this time, and maybe not ever, which I can understand. But at the same time, it is the issue. I always call it to these fellows, I say it's the elephant in the room. Eventually, you can't get away from it because we don't know what's happening to people. And something is. But here's the critical thing that we don't know, at least not publicly. We don't know whether or not the abduction and close encounter phenomena are connected to the objects that we are making videos of, the U.S. Navy has released videos of. We don't have a certainty about that connection. Now, this gets me to wanting to talk about James McCatsky and Colin Kelleher and George Knapp's new book, Skinwalkers at the Pentagon. Colin Kelleher and George Knapp will be on Dreamland next week. And I thought, you told me off the air that you hadn't read the book yet. but that you can speak of it because you know a lot about the programs. So I would like your thoughts about the book and what has happened here, because I think it's quite an important change, in fact, a sea change.
It is a very important book, and as you say, I've not read it yet. It is on its way to me, but the reason it's important, I mean, obviously, George Knapp and Colm Kelleher are huge figures in this field, and what they have to say is very, very important. But the third of those authors, James Lukacsky, is, I think, critically important in all of this. And a lot of people, it staggers me. A lot of people don't quite get who he is and where he fits in with this. But when the New York Times broke the story about the Pentagon's ATIP program, one of the things that happened, I guess, over the next few months and moving forward, is one or two bits of paperwork about this began to emerge. So, for example, we have a DIA letter to Congress about ATIP, listing the 38 scientific studies that were done under the OSAP program, OSAP being the contract associated with ATIP, though there's still a debate about the line between the two and what happened when the program was transitioned out of Defense Intelligence Agency back into to main Department of Defense. But let me set that aside. We also have a letter from former Senate Majority Leader Harry Reid to a Deputy Secretary of Defense talking about ATIP. But one of the other critical pieces of paperwork that we have is the original contractual solicitation, where Defense Intelligence Agency said, we want to do a study on all this. This is what we want. And there it was. If you went through, I can't remember how many pages there were to this, maybe 30 or 40, a lot of it fairly standard government contractual blurb. But when it listed the COR, the contracting officer's representative, it was James Lukacsky. Now, the contracting officer's representative is the key person in the chain. They are the interface between the contractor, in this case, Bigelow Aerospace, that actually did a lot of this work originally, and the government. And so the COR is the link. They are the ones who keep the contractor on time and on target so that they produce the deliverables that the government has paid for. So that's who Lukacsky is. And for him now to be speaking out on this and going into some of the details about all this, and you can there's a sort of chain to this. Robert Bigelow is fairly critical. He had his National Institute of Discovery Science. Then he had his Bigelow Aerospace Advanced Scientific Study. Then that segued into ATIP and OSAP, and then brings us to the present day. So Lukacsky speaking out about this is very important. And unsurprisingly, his manuscript, this book, needed to be security cleared by the government. Yes. And by all accounts, that took around about 14 months. Now, my book on the Rendlesham Forest incident had to go through that same process, both in the UK and the US. It did not take 14 months. Now, obviously, COVID is a factor. A lot of people were, and still are probably, working from home during this, but it's still a long time. So it does not equate, the government have not endorsed the contents of this book. That's not what security vetting is, obviously, but they have obviously felt, as with all people who've had access to classified information, that they needed to see the manuscript before it was published. And that's what's happened with this book. So I'm very much looking forward to reading it, not least because these people always find a way, as I did, to telling you, reading, letting people read between the lines, not divulging classified information, But to those in the know, there are things there if you know where to look and how to read.
And one of the things I'd like to do after they come on is to have you come back after you've read the book and discuss exactly that. And I'm also going to have John Hernandez, hopefully, who is a CIA officer who was on Dreamland just recently, discussing how to ask Freedom of Information Act questions that or file Freedom of Information Act requests correctly with the right agencies, and which U.S. agencies were responsible for what type of data, so that people can file these more meaningfully, rather than what happens is that every day that passes, the Central Intelligence Agency gets hundreds of FOIA requests about UFOs, and the other agencies don't get any. So people don't understand how to do it, but we now I think maybe that'll get. In any case, I think that your take on this book and on what he's done is going to be extremely interesting. Now, we're going to take another brief break for Free Dreamlanders. And when we come back, I want to go back to the Rendlesham Forest case, which is so fascinating. And there are so many still unanswered questions. There's a lot to talk about. We'll be right back. There's a new world coming if we can take it. What does that mean? The first part of the message is, if we can take it for ourselves on our own terms. The second part of the message is, can we bear the newness and the huge expansion of human consciousness that is going to be involved? Can we take it? A new world. It doesn't mince words. It tells the good, the bad, and the ugly like it is. And it leaves a message behind. Can you do this? Do you want to? Do we have an alternative? Right now, at this point in history, mankind is either going to get a lot bigger or not. I choose to go forward. I choose to live for and in the future. I choose the future. A new world. We can take it. Available in hardcover, softcover, audiobook, and Kindle. At Nick Pope Mod. That's at Nick Pope Mod, and that's where you will find him most often on Twitter. And I can assure you, as I am a follower of Nick Pope Mod, it is quite an interesting Twitter feed. It never fails to be fascinating. Now, before we left the air, and I had an allergy attack, which my listeners all know about, but you didn't have to see it this time. We were talking, getting ready to talk more about Rendlesham, which Nick knows an enormous amount about. And I wonder, Nick, if there is any material that has come to light or that you are aware of now that you perhaps couldn't talk about in the past that you feel comfortable talking about now? Or is the thing sort of kind of left where it was?
Well, things are going on in relation to this. And the two related areas, well, you know, actually so closely related, they're all almost the same issue. It's the whole issue of human effects of this phenomenon, whatever we're dealing with. Now, I, some years ago, teamed up with two of the key witnesses, John Burroughs and Jim Penniston, and also as another member of the team, a crusading lawyer, this time not Danny Sheehan, another one, Pat Frasconia, who put in hundreds of hours of pro bono work on this and included Freedom of Information Act requests in this. But the problem was that a number of the Rendlesham witnesses had health issues that they attributed to this close encounter that took place in December 1980 in the United Kingdom. Now, these were United States Air Force personnel at the twin bases of Bentwaters and Woodbridge. And the reason why this is a difficult one is because, of course, medical confidentiality rules limit what I can say about this, even, I think, with the consent of some of the people involved. And I want to err on the side of caution with this. But the late John McCain, Senator John McCain, and also Senator John Kyle became involved with this. There are some documents that I don't think have yet emerged about this. There was a very proactive staffer in, my goodness, I've gone a mental blank. I think John McClain's office, or maybe John Kyle's office, but Cheryl Bennett.
I believe it was in McCain's office, but I don't remember the staffer's name.
Right, Cheryl Bennett. And
impressive. Congratulations.
And she did a lot of the heavy lifting on this. So there is a lot going on, not much of which can be publicly discussed in relation to that. And I played a small but key role in this because there was a British Ministry of Defense intelligence assessment of the UFO phenomenon in its entirety, codenamed Project Condyne. It went down a few rabbit holes, I have to say, but
yeah, I've read Project Condyne. There are a few rabbit holes, all right.
But one of the good things in it was that it did contain a statement where it said, in relation to the Rendlesham Forest incident, that it might be postulated that the witnesses were exposed to unidentified aerial phenomena radiation for longer periods of time than is usual. And on the basis of that quote, in this declassified secret UK eyes only document, Pat Fresconia and Cheryl Bennett and John McCain and John Kyle were able to go back to the VA and say, hey, you know, you said that you weren't going to pay out on any of this or settle or engage because this is just crazy UFO talk. Well, look, here it is in a British Ministry of Defense document saying these people were probably exposed. And so that opened some doors. So that's one side of it. One of the related sides is, I mentioned earlier, this DIA letter to Congress listing the 38 scientific studies done under the ATIP contractual program, OSAP. One of them, again, relates to human effects. And again, we only have the titles to most of these studies and not the actual papers, but people like Kip Green were involved, and Colm Kelleher and a number of others. So all of this, you can join the dots with all these people, most of whom I think you know anyway.
Yes, and, of course.
And so you begin to build this picture, but the human effect side of this, which in a way brings us back to abduction, though perhaps no one wants to quite come out and say it, but it is there. It's there in the paperwork that went to Congress, but kind of dressed up as human effects and biological effects and things like that. So again, it's a kind of coded language sometimes.
I was always interested in the choice of the name Condyne because it means appropriate. And I, you know, you see it in old legal documents, Condyne punishment. And I wondered why you have any idea who chose that title and why the word Condyne?
The official answer is that all Ministry of Defense code names are supposed to come randomly off a computer. And they're supposed to be a list of words that, for example, can't be mistaken if they're said over the phone or a military radio or something with another word. So and that's why British operation names have such, in a way, boring titles. So, yeah, for example, the Falklands War was Operation Corporate. The First Gulf War was Operation Granby. Now, one time we did a humanitarian aid operation, I think in maybe it was Sierra Leone or something like that. And one of these awful random code names came off the computer. And the chief of defense staff said, oh, for goodness sake, can't we have something a little bit more purposeful? So actually, that op got called Operation Purposeful. Now, Condyne, and so since then, we have from time to time chosen more appropriate code words. But Condyne, they say, was just random. I don't think it was. I think someone was having a little in-joke about a justified punishment. Oh my goodness, I'm having to do this UFO study after the Ministry of Defense has told everyone for decades, we don't do this. And it's exactly. Of no defense. Yeah, here I am. And of course, the second strand to it is it's a pun on the Condon report.
Well, that exactly. That's why I didn't think it was random. And because it also obscures the issue without denying the truth, just like the Condon report does. The truth is in the report itself, but the obscuring of the issue is in the preface to it.
Yes. Now, I was involved. I was involved in 1993 and 1994 in the work that led to the setting up of this study, but I certainly didn't choose the name for it. And I had been posted to another division. This whole work stream was delayed. I'd been promoted and posted elsewhere by the time it got underway. So I played no part in the study aside from setting it up or helping to.
Just the report, which I have read in its entirety carefully, it comes to a number of conclusions. I think the most interesting of these conclusions is that it could be that something, some kind of radiant energy or some sort of energy causes people to believe that they have had these abduction experiences and close encounter experiences, and yet that these experiences don't physically happen. Is that a fair description of that estimate in the report or not? I'm not sure. Or am I going off the stream?
No, I think it's pretty close. Yeah, absolutely. I think exotic atmospheric plasma phenomena.
That's exactly what they speak of, yes.
But then, you know, I think the problem is that he then tried to shoehorn that pet theory into a whole load of data where, frankly, it didn't fit. And he ended up, I think, firstly making the mistake of trying to explain one unknown phenomenon with another.
Exactly. You're so good at this, Nick. I'm so pleased to have you on the show. Go ahead.
Well, and secondly, attributing to it, as a result of trying to make these data fit, all sorts of things which frankly became so unlikely that Occam's razor was not only stretched, it was broken into 1,000 pieces.
Pieces, yes. So but, you go ahead.
Yeah, so he came up with this theory, and I sometimes wondered whether he wasn't wanting to come out and almost endorse some of the old Trevor James Constable theories about sky critters and some of the Wilhelm Reich stuff, because he was almost implying a sort of intelligence to these atmospheric phenomena. That they could kind of do this, but yes. Maybe that's a bridge too far. But I think one of the other mistakes he made was underplaying the hand of how much of this is tracked on radar and recorded on forward-looking infrared cameras mounted on military jets, for example. Now, the tech was not as good back when he was writing that report as it is now. But even so, I think he sold it short by saying this isn't physically real, because we did have gun camera footage. We did have radar data that would have contradicted that.
Even then we had it. Mm-hmm. Now, what hasn't been talked about at all is the proliferation of satellites, look down satellites looking down, many of them now with multiple different sensor levels of sensor, with not just ordinary light, but a lot of different sensors. So far, none of that material has come out into the public eye. There must be a great deal of it by this point, because if radars can pick these things up, and in fact, Melinda Leslie out in Sedona picks them up by just using a night vision lens, a night vision system. We must be able to pick up a great deal of material with satellites that are looking down, spy satellites in effect. Yet not a word, not a whisper of any of the existence of any of this material, not certainly in the tiny, embarrassingly small public threat assessment, and I don't believe in the classified one either. What do you make of that? Shouldn't that data be quite extensive by now?
My goodness, I think we've kind of gotten to the most interesting and sensitive part of this whole business that's currently going on with Congress. And it's not quite a question of not a word, but my goodness, there was a heavy hint dropped and then crickets. Here's what happened. Shortly before the end of last year, and I don't know exactly the date, but former Director of National Intelligence John Ratcliffe went on to Fox News and gave an interview. And I can't remember what the interview was about. Maybe it was about China or something like that. But at the end, the host asked about UFOs. And John Ratcliffe gave her an answer. And towards the end of his answer, he said, and I'm paraphrasing, but he said something like this: "We've got a lot of data." He said, "So it's not just a pilot sighting here or something on satellite there." So he dropped it into the conversation that this existed. And probably only somebody at DNI rank could get away with doing that, because this is obviously so highly classified and so sensitive in terms even of what the precise capabilities of these systems are, that perhaps only a former DNI, as I say, could get away with it. But he did it. He dropped it into the conversation provocatively and deliberately, I am sure. I don't think you get to DNI without knowing exactly what you are doing. And you don't have a little oops moment where you think, oh, I shouldn't have said that. I'm sure he said it deliberately. And to put it out there, so far, it's not really been picked up by the mainstream news media. The 9-page unclassified summary that we have dated June 25th from Office of Director of National Intelligence to Congress doesn't mention it at all. It may be that the classified version, which I understand is double the length, so 18 pages, mentions it, or it may be that it doesn't. I don't know. I haven't seen it. So, but absolutely, 100%, Whitley, satellites are going to be one of the key kind of keys to unlocking this whole mystery.
Another thing that hasn't been discussed is the effort that has been made by the National Reconnaissance Office to look back on their movements into and out of the solar system to try to determine where they are coming from. Now, I'm not even sure that when we do that, we're looking at what is actually coming and going. In other words, if it could be that this isn't even a matter of things coming and going from other planets, that it's something that's happening here exclusively. In other words, it's an earthly phenomenon. Not that I mean that it grew up here, but that at some time, perhaps even in the distant past, somebody came here and has been here ever since. And how they got here is such an extraordinary question, because even if you think in terms of movement at the speed of light, the speed of light is slower than the hour hand on a watch in terms of interstellar speeds, interstellar movement, a lot slower. Light creeps through the universe so slowly that you can't imagine going anywhere at the speed of light, anywhere significant. I mean, most stars that seem important to us are thousands of light years away. So how would they get here? Do you have any ideas? You must have thought about this. Or are they already here?
Well, I mean, as you say, light speed is kind of dead slow, not quite stop, but certainly dead slow. And at light speed, it would take 4.3 years to get to the nearest star, aside from our own sun. If we were going at the speed of the fastest space probes that we've yet sent, had the Voyager or the Pioneer probes been aimed directly at Proxima Centauri, say, I mean, they're not, but had they been, they would, at that speed, take about 75,000 years to get there. At light speed, 4.3 years. But yeah, viable interstellar travel at light speed would be difficult. Zeta 2 Reticuli sits at about 37 light years from Earth, and that, of course, has come up in the literature. But it's still a big ask. So I think go back to that letter that the DIA sent to Congress. One of the 38 studies listed, and you know, it's amazing to see this going to Congress from DIA, mentions warp speed. One mentions wormholes. One, and this is a word that I never thought I would see in a DIA letter to Congress, mentions stargates. So
yes.
So who knows?
And let's talk about all of those further. But free Dreamlanders, it's time for us to say adios to you. I suggest you subscribe to the website and join its wonderful, warm social media community. Know that it is a beautiful group of people. And also, you can enjoy listening to the whole show every week instead of listening to me tempt you. Thank you so much for being with us, Free Dreamlanders.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.